In this bulletin, against a backdrop of apartheid's legacy of dispossession, leaders of the major people's organizations within South Africa express their views in a call for total immediate sanctions by the international community against the South African government. Six months into the second state of emergency, an estimated 22,000 people have been detained. Roughly 8,000 are children between 9 and 18 years of age. This is Driefontein, a self-sufficient black subsistence farming community established on freehold land purchased in the Eastern Transvaal in 1912. When rains are good, the community of landowners and tenants produce enough to feed themselves and a surplus for sale at the local market. With its solid and well-kept houses, boreholes, handful of shops, churches and schools, Driefontein is one of the few surviving examples of the black subsistence farming economy that prospered across South Africa at the end of the 19th century. In the early 1900s, when black landowners were acknowledged as the prosperous small farmers of the community, the history of systematic black dispossession was just beginning. Tax legislation designed to force the black farmer off the land and compel him to become a wage earner on the mines was introduced. Land acts followed, depriving blacks of access to land, the vital agricultural subsistence base of their economy and survival. The destruction and mass-scale relocation of established black farming communities with the implementation of apartheid and its Bantustan policy in 1948 consolidated this process of dispossession. Through apartheid legislation, a once productive subsistence farming community has been reduced to a dispossessed, landless mass. The impoverished and overcrowded homelands, constituting 14% of South Africa, were designed as reservoirs of exploitable black labor to service the needs of the prosperous white economy. Over the past 40 years, the South African government has expediently exported poverty and black unemployment into the designated Bantustans. As a result, today, only 8% of black rural communities exist as subsistence farmers. Over 9 million black South Africans in the rural areas live below the poverty datum line. Over 1.5 million have no measurable income whatsoever. These findings and their direct relationship to the policies pursued by the South African government have been highlighted in the findings of the second Carnegie Inquiry into Poverty in South Africa, instituted by the American-based Carnegie Corporation.
Arising out of the Carnegie Inquiry, a lot of thinking has been done about the causes of poverty in South Africa, and clearly it is very silly to think that poverty in South Africa is unlike that anywhere else in the world. Of course, there's poverty all over the world. But we do find, when we look at causes, that there are some factors in the South African society that exacerbate poverty here. And those factors do relate directly to government policy. Or rather the policy of the wider political economy, let me put it that way, that if I can take three aspects for the moment. First would be the whole migrant labor system, which of course began long before apartheid. It began with the development of the mining industry in the late 19th century. That policy, of course, was reinforced by this government when they came to power in 1948. But that pattern of migrant labor, of workers coming out of rural areas to work in the mines and the factories for a limited period of time and then go back to their families and then come back again, that process of oscillation has been going on for 100 years, and that is a major factor which has helped cause poverty in the rural areas.
The development of deep-level mining demanded thousands of unskilled migrant laborers who were housed in mining compounds, the forerunner of today's single-sex hostels. But at this time, the black subsistence farmer was self-sufficient and independently prosperous, either as a squatter on white-owned land or as a landowner farmer in his own right. To meet the labor demands of the mining industry, the government devised a strategy for forcing black farmers off the land. Hut and poll taxes for blacks, to be paid in currency and not in cattle, were introduced. A labour tax was instituted, which was payable unless a black man could prove that he had worked for wages for 3 months of the year. In this way, black men were forced to leave the land and go to the mines as migrant workers. In 1913, the Land Act prohibited blacks from owning and farming land in 90% of South Africa. This established the annual and self-perpetuating poverty cycle of able-bodied men leaving their destitute families in the impoverished and overcrowded reserves to go and work in the mines and factories for 11 months of the year.
The second one is the Land Act, that legislation which confines or says that land in most of South Africa, 80% of the land or more, can be owned only by whites, and black South Africans may not purchase that land. And that is a second major exacerbating factor of poverty in South Africa. A third, more recent phenomenon is the whole resettlement policy, which, as you know, it's estimated by the Surplus People Project, who did a major inquiry into this, that something like 3.5 million people have been moved over the last 30 years. Most of them moved into the reserves. Some of those people not moved into the reserve, but moved from one part of a city to another under the Group Areas Act. And almost everywhere where there has been analysis, whether by the Surplus People Project or by the Carnegie Inquiry, it is clear that that process of resettlement has helped exacerbate poverty by breaking down communities and so on.
The real watershed year on the destruction of the black subsistence farmer was 1913, the Land Act of that year. With that, the black man, the black family, could no longer, except in 8% of cases, glean enough from the land to survive on. And with the men forced into a migrant society where, again, the wages, the wage structures, the various wage determinations were geared to one person rather than to a man and a family he had to support. This set up the patterns of poverty, the patterns of non-survival, which were then massively compounded by relocation, black spot clearance, etc.
In the reserves, the homelands, the black national states, whatever we want to call them, it is estimated as a rough measure that of the order of 4/5, 81% of the black families, households living in those areas are living below the poverty datum line.
With the various programs that we've been implementing on self-help and community development, we find that our greatest problem is the non-availability of suitable land, in fact, of any land at all. We are acutely aware that the best of our programs only bring people up to minimum survival.
Deterioration in the situation of the black rural community caused by the continued application of apartheid laws, in spite of a prosperous South African economy, indicate that there is no intention in government policy to reverse the trends of institutionalized black rural poverty. With 14% of the land allocated to South Africa's majority black community, overcrowding, malnutrition and poverty take their toll, particularly amongst the aged and the very young.
I mean, we have 55% of all deaths in the black community are children under five. A normal Western percentage would be 7%. The mystery of rural survival is something I've never come to terms with. I think basically there is the biggest factor is this incredible extended family pattern, this, you know, devoted Ubuntu, which is quite untranslatable. It's a mixture of compassion and caring and sharing.
Operation Hunger is a self-help organization responding to appeals from destitute communities and working at grassroots level through organizations with established infrastructure and credibility within the community. It has two basic objectives. In the short term, hunger relief and malnutrition prevention, particularly in the very young and aged. in the long term, the establishment of self-help projects. At present, Operation Hunger receives the bulk of its financial support from within South Africa. With the continued decline in the South African economy and a possible backlash in white sentiment, prompted by calls from the black community for punitive international economic action, there is a real danger that Operation Hunger will be critically affected.
Look, I do believe that we must survive. We are already feeding just over 1 million people. These are people, children. The majority of them are children. And somehow or another, we have got to survive. We have to help them.
For meaningful change to occur in South Africa, the necessity of total international sanctions against the present government becomes increasingly inevitable. To counteract negative sentiment and consequent lack of support from white South Africans, and to meet the ever-increasing demand in the number of appeals from destitute rural communities, Operation Hunger must look to the international community for support if it is to survive.
We have already started looking for funding from the overseas community.
Are indications such that you believe that you will get the required funding from the international sources to help you survive?
I think it's too early to tell at this point. But basically, somehow or another, we just have to. You know, Operation Hunger has basically gone forward in faith since 1980, and we'll just go on doing that.
I think part of the argument about South Africa, and certainly my belief, is that the policies pursued by this government, sanctions or no sanctions, that those policies actually are economically harmful to the black population, and that it is those policies that need to be changed, the entrenched racism within the South African political, economic, legal structure need to be changed if one is really going to deal adequately with the issue of poverty. I mean, one of the points that came out of the inquiry quite clearly is that if one is serious about getting to grips with poverty in South Africa, it is absolutely essential that the poor, by which generally one means the black population in South Africa, have to have real political power. Therefore, a necessary prerequisite for a proper attack on poverty in South Africa requires a democratic society. That, in other words, that distribution of political power is a fundamental prerequisite for coming to grips with the issue of poverty.
The sanctions is, I think, the last moral option left for people who are concerned in the rest of the world about what's happening here. Sanctions on its own, I don't think, will bring down the apartheid system. I don't think that very serious advocates of sanctions can ever believe that sanctions alone will bring down this government. It has to be a combination of external and internal factors. The internal factors are already there because great resistance has been seen against apartheid in particular over the last 2 years. That on its own will not have the effect of making this government move from its intransigent position. But combined with the effect of sanctions, combined with the effect of a cultural boycott of this country, it can have the effect of forcing the krachtdadig mentality of the ruling class to change.
Well, we should look at sanctions as really one method amongst a number of varied approaches to the issue of liberation inside South Africa. Part of the approach we have argued in the past is the armed struggle. Worker strikes, worker agitation, community struggles, rent boycotts are all part of the struggle which go up to make the totality of our struggle for liberation. And we believe that the sanctions program that CUSA adopted back in 1984 and that the CUSA ZAKTU Federation has adopted now is merely part of that program of resistance for total liberation.
The institution of sanctions and the The boycott of South Africa at all levels, sporting, cultural and otherwise, is of absolute necessity, because it actually contributes in the final analysis to the total amount of pressure that would be required, you know, to pressurize the South African government to realize that there is no way it can continue ruling the country as it is. And that we do not say, and I think it will be completely incorrect were we to say so, that through sanctions the government can change. What we are saying is that sanctions coupled with other measures, coupled with other activities, in the main and first and foremost internal political activity, would actually constitute the total attack, you know, that is necessary to begin to get apartheid, in fact, to be removed. And for us, therefore, the arguments would be made that, I mean, how do you want to bite the hand that feeds you? Or, I mean, but sanctions will hurt blacks more than, in fact, the people it's supposed to, you know. Our argument is fairly simple on that one, you know. And our argument actually derives from the example of the trade union movement and the struggles that the workers are fighting in the factories, that for them to get a better deal from management, they are forced from time to time to go on strike. And going on strike, in fact, has the danger of the workers being fired from work, losing their job, or even of the company closing at some point in time. But those are necessary risks and necessary sacrifices that we have to take in order to be able to achieve our goal.
Well, inevitably, suffering is going to increase, with or without sanctions. Already, the statistics indicate that over 5 million people are unemployed. The statistics also indicate that white employment is increasing, whereas black unemployment is simultaneously increasing. So without heavy total sanctions, black people are in the pit already of suffering. They've been suffering for a long time. I think the existence of black people, black existence in this country, is one of suffering. It will increase at an economic level, but I don't think only as a result of sanctions. Sanctions, I think, will be probably the cherry on the cake. But the suffering, the scale of suffering, has been increasing steadily because of the repressive and exploitative policies of the present government. Sanctions will merely accelerate that suffering. It will create immediate hardships for people. But more importantly, sanctions is going to also increase white suffering, because whites are going to feel for the first time the effect of what it is like to have sanctions imposed against them. And black people, for all their lives, have had sanctions imposed against them internally.
Well, the whole mechanism of apartheid has been kept in place because of the capitalistic nature of our society and the alliance that has been formed between our country and its present leaders and capitalists in the Western world. And as such, we would foresee that if that lifeblood of capital was not attacked, then apartheid would continue forever and ever. We have, in our view, considered that we have to hit at that lifeblood and cut that stream off, and therefore we took a decision that there should be no new investment in this country. And we believe that it's through such a program of sanctions that we will be able to cripple the economy, which will create an internal tension, which will eventually lead to view within Pretoria that they have to concede to the majority view in this country.
The October decision by the United States Senate to impose a program of economic sanctions against South Africa took a confident and arrogant Botha government by surprise. The move was generally welcomed by black South Africans, with a stunned white reaction indicating a major psychological blow to the South African government and to those white supporters of its apartheid policies.
I think workers are very aware of what a sanctions program means. Workers are also aware that it is through their power that foreign capital has been able to create wealth. They are also aware that they have not been the beneficiaries of this wealth through the low wages that they receive through the apartheid system and the homeland system. They know that their own people are suffering. They witness starvation, they witness hunger. During periods of strike, they see white managers unable to cope with production processes. So they perceive themselves as the creators of wealth in our society. And as such, they're quite conscious of their role. They believe that if they are not able to take a stand on this issue and suffer further, then their children and their grandchildren will never see liberation in our country. And this is a commitment that workers have made.
I firmly believe that they should be applied and that their application will actually facilitate our struggle for freedom. And many people have argued that sanction will deprive black people of employment. And we have argued, and in fact black workers have argued strongly, that it is better to be oppressed temporarily by perhaps not having your jobs than to be oppressed for so many, many years, and that we are prepared to pay the price for our emancipation. And that is that.
Well, if I may kick off by saying, people, they've been singing this gospel of sanction. If there's a sanction, the black people will be hit more harder than the white. To me, it's just utter nonsense. Because sanction, it was already somewhere, yes, when the government has implemented the influence control, whatever they call it, indirectly they were implementing the sanction. So at this stage, I think everybody is quite clear that people still believe that we should negotiate rather than violence. So the negotiation failed now. So the best thing now to apply little pressure to put a sanction, because only a solution now is left. Other than that, now we should now devote ourselves to the violence.
They've been going through influx control. They've been going through quite a number of unnecessary things in this country. So they've suffered enough, and they're still suffering. And there's no doubt that they will suffer, but these sufferings will not be new for them. So it's normal for them to suffer. But we believe that these sufferings should come to an end one day, and we believe that full sanctions would be able to bring necessary pressure.
That, again, we're not able, the ordinary man, a black person, is not able to afford a loaf of bread. So that is going to cause a lot of suffering as such on our people. And you can see right away that people are suffering as such. So because people are suffering, we believe the only alternative that is left is that in order to achieve our goal, because of the white people of this country are not aware of our sufferings, they are living in an isolated area, isolated land, so they to drive a message home is that we should all suffer. And the only way at this moment to let them know and to understand the situation in our country is that the sanctions should be applied, and they will actually feel the pinch.
If one looks at the capital investment that goes to the banks, that goes to the government, it will definitely affect whites. If the government cannot have enough money to pay all the whites that are employed in the civil service, as well as the banks that are lending money to big business in this country, whites will be affected. If one looks at total workforce in South Africa, as well as the American investment in this country, total number of people who are employed by, say, American companies country are not exceeding even 80,000. So the bulk of that investment is not in labor intensive, but it's in capital intensive. So it don't affect black people more. It will affect whites also.
Well, like in all struggles, there will be casualties. But that is, in fact, one of the things that we take into consideration when we struggle. That there's no struggle where we will not have this or that. But we prefer that pressure must be applied to the South African government in order that we facilitate the freedom of black people. Because the alternative to that, actually,
will be very dangerous.
The army is shooting us every day in the townships. So these sanctions, actually, they are long overdue.
The disinvestment of IBM, General Motors, and Kodak from South Africa brings the total number of American withdrawals to 63 this year. The withdrawal of Barclays UK represents the biggest single disinvestment move by an overseas company yet. Despite the initial bravado displayed by the South African government in the face of sanctions threats, foreign trade is the lifeblood of the South African economy, accounting for a sizable 60% of gross domestic product.
But what has become obvious since, in fact, the whole sanctions issue has begun gathering momentum is that, in fact, it is beginning to hurt the government. I mean, they may not want to say so, you know, but what is quite clear is that the economy in South Africa is very, very much vulnerable to foreign investors, in fact, pulling out. And the fact that they would go to such great lengths to try and persuade international public opinion against sanctions is in itself a pointer to the fact that the more, in fact, sanctions that we could have, the more pressure that, in fact, would be exerted on the South African government.
Well, the international community can put more pressures, like preventing South African official South African visitors, preventing elements of the ruling class from gaining access to their own countries, restricting them to South Africa only in terms of all their commerce, whether it is trade, whether it is social, sporting, cultural. And that type of pressure, the ruling class cannot really take, despite the rah-rah reaction that they've been having so far. They cannot take that type of pressure because social ostracization is a very effective way of forcing anybody who is engaged in this type of practice to begin to look at themselves.
We actually have no moral problems about the whole question of sanctions or about sanctions actually being imposed on the government. We hold the view that any such measures that are strong enough to actually bring home to the South African government that the international community cannot afford to sit idly by while Botha and his Nationalist Party play political games with the majority of our people in South Africa, and thereby, in fact, threatening as well the peace not only in Southern Africa but in the whole world. And that, in fact, is the moral issue that the whole world must face, not whether we will suffer more. I think that we as organizations representing people in this country have the right, you know, to make the decisions that would clearly be seen, that will clearly advance, in fact, the cause for liberation in this country, and that we do not think that it is correct for people from outside, you know, to want to determine what, I mean, how best we can free ourselves. I think we are masters of the situation. We know what it is like, you know, and we accept the fact that for liberation to come around, there is no question of genuine liberation here in this country coming on a silver plate. It is something that has to be struggled for. Already, hundreds of our people have died in this cause for liberation, you know. Already, thousands of workers have lost their jobs because they dared, in fact, to challenge management and go on strike for better living conditions and better wages, you know. And we know that thousands more of South Africans may be forced to leave the country, you know, in order to avoid detention and the consequences that follow detention. So clearly, therefore, when we say that sanctions and other forms of pressure are necessary, you know, to assist the movement in this country, we really mean that it is not because it's out of malice or short-sightedness on our part.
Yes, we would believe that the European community needs to take a position, and we would believe that both Chancellor Kohl as well as Margaret Thatcher's administrations have to take a more enlightened position. We can recognize at one level that they are concerned about jobs in their country. We can also take a view that they have many investments in this country and would want a just return on that investment. At the same time, we need to be conscious of the fact that it were black workers who went into North Africa and fought in the Second World War to ensure that there was freedom and justice for people in Europe. And it is an arrogance on the part of people like Margaret Thatcher, as well as Chancellor Cole, to forget this. When the parents and grandparents of black workers in our country went out into North Africa to fight for liberation, their liberation, they now have to return and fight or at least assist in our liberation, which they're refusing to do.
This country today is where it is. I mean, the conflict and the violence is intensifying precisely because from the 50s, from the 60s, the ANC and other organizations have been making representations and calling on the international community to act decisively, but there was procrastination. But today, we are witnessing an advance in terms of the liberation forces in this country, and all of a sudden, there is now that international interest in this country. But it comes in different forms, some of which as represented by Helmut Kohl, Margaret Thatcher, and President Reagan, is interest that seeks, in fact, to delay the process of liberation in this country. And they are still thinking in terms of giving Botha a chance. You know, we are convinced that there is no second chance that there is here, and that the struggle continues despite, in fact, their attempts at trying to create a breathing space for the Botha government.
Under constant siege by security forces waging a localized civil war, for the black community, suffering the daily indignities of oppression in the townships, the moralizing arguments against sanctions put forward by some prominent leaders of the international community ring hollow and are interpreted as expedient backpedaling tactics.
That is a false morality, because people left their jobs here, people left their homes here to fight for peace and justice in the world during the Second World War. What sort of morality are we actually talking about? And I believe quite clearly that the British people owe the South African nation as a whole to protect them from the scourge of Nazism. The German people themselves owe it to the free world and to South Africans that they have something to return to us. To date, they have not returned that, either in political action or economic action.
Gregory, when were you detained?
I was detained on the 26th June.
Where were you and what were you doing at the time of when you were detained?
I was at home, I was asleep.
What time was it?
It's about 4 o'clock in the morning.
Will you describe what happened when they came to get you?
The came with a lady. That lady pointed at me and they said, "I'm the one which is conducting the people's court." And they take me off.
How many were there that came to get you?
They were mean. I was not having even a chance to count them.
What did your mother and father think when this happened?
I tried to explain to them that I'm not involved in those things, and they just didn't take that thing. They just took me off.
Over the past 6 months, since the imposition of the second state of emergency, the South African government has effectively waged war against its black child population. The total number of detentions since the state of emergency was declared on June 12th this year is estimated at 22,000. Of these, 8,000 are believed to be children 9 to 18 years of age. Anti-apartheid and human rights organizations have also been prime targets. After lying low for 4 months to avoid possible detention, detainee's parents' support committee advisor, Daphne Mashila, was detained 4 days after she came out of hiding to resume work at the DPSC advice office in Johannesburg.
I was scared in the sense that while he was interrogating me, my next door, the next interrogation room, there was someone who was being interrogated. And although there are soundproofs in the interrogation room, but I could hear someone screaming in the next room. And the interrogator was asking him questions and kept on saying, "Do you have brains?" And then that person kept on saying, "Yes, I do have brains. What do you have here?" And then it went on and jet kak, jet ni brains, you know, that kind of thing. And I could hear that they were either strangling him, because I could hear that he was battling to breath and the chair was moving. But I knew that they were assaulting him and he was screaming. And I could hear those screams. And obviously I was scared, because I knew that it was also coming to me. And particularly for the fact that I knew that when you are being detained, obviously you're going to be tortured. But when you get it, like I've been seeing a lot of detainees, you don't actually believe it until you see it or you hear it with your own ears. So I was really scared.
Were you interrogated during your detention?
Yes, I was interrogated.
Will you describe what happened during your interrogation?
They beating us, forcing us to say what they were thinking we were doing is right. And when we say to them we don't know about that, about those things, they just beat us and said we know everything. Yes.
How long were you kept in detention?
It's 4 months. It's 4 months up and 26 days.
Initiated by the Black Sash, a Free the Children campaign has been launched in South Africa. Supported by medical, church and people's organizations, the campaign includes a Christmas card petition to the state president to release all detained children by Christmas.
Once again, when it comes to the type of society that can actually jail children, normally societies, any sort of what one calls civilized society, has the protection of the children very much in mind. And one finds it incredible that within South Africa there can be children as young as 9 years, 11 years, 12 years, who are detained for considerable lengths of time and held in jails on maybe incidents which can produce charges, but a lot of the time they're just taken in and released without ever having been charged. And I think the type of society that can brutalize its children in this particular sort of way is a very, very dangerous society. What are we actually doing to our youth?
We find that we've got a lot of children who, between 12 and 14, we find that their families have been going to police station, from police station to police station for months, and they're unable to trace where their kids are. For instance, I'll quote the case of Mrs. Mudibedi from Kagiso, whose child, William, who's 11, was taken, I think, early in October. And up until now, she's been told that she's at Deep Kloof, and she actually received a letter notifying her that she's been transferred from Roodepoort Police Station to Deep Kloof. When she goes to Deep Kloof, Deep Kloof will say she's not at Deep Kloof, but she's at Krugersdorp Prison. And, you know, that kind of thing, the next week it will be the same. And that particular case, it is an exceptional case in the sense that she's got 4 children who are detained now. And when she's got to see the others without seeing the youngest of the children, she really, you know, had problems, and she had to come to the DPSC office. And some people from the office phoned the measure in Deep Kloof, and she actually said that the child was in Deep Kloof, and we sent the mother to Deep Kloof, and she went to Deep Kloof, and she couldn't find the child at Deep Kloof. And I think up until today, she's not been able to see the little boy. And she got information from someone that the little boy was going to be interrogated on Tuesday after she went to Deep Kloof Prison on Monday. And, you know, she didn't know what to do at that time, how to stop the police from actually interrogating the little boy, you know.
How old is he?
He's 11.
The state of emergency laws overrule the Child Care Act. And so that means that children have been placed into detention and even more of concern to us is the children arrested as on public violence charges and arson charges, who are put in as with awaiting trial prisoners. So that means that they are put in with adults who are not politically aware and who are sometimes common criminals. And one has enormous concerns about those children.
As maybe you know, the effects of detention on young children have not really been kind of studied in any detail. But what we've found is that they come with much the same as the adults come with, but more severe. I mean, they get a thing which we call post-traumatic stress disorder, which people say they can't concentrate, they can't sleep, they startle easily, they have nightmares about their detention, those types of things. They can't relate well to their families. They're very restless and generally feel very uncomfortable. And although they can't see that they have any physical problems, they don't feel well. They have a kind of generalized body unease, is what they complain about. Also dizziness and difficulty with vision.
Were you yourself physically tortured at all during this time?
Yes, I was physically tortured.
Would you just describe what kind of torture you suffered?
Sometimes when you have done about a mistake, they were just taking you to a solitary cell. And if you don't get papers, such things, and you stay alone there. Sometimes they beat you with something like they call them donkey pills. It's just something like a shambok.
They're interrogated. They're often beaten up. They're also put in a kind of catch-22 situation when they come out, where they're often warned by the security police that if they continue their activities, they're going to be arrested again. And then their comrades kind of feel, well, if they aren't going to carry on the struggle, you know, they've obviously sold out. So they're in a terrible dilemma, actually, when they come out, and it's very difficult for them to decide what to do.
These children are suffering from nightmares. They are becoming quite disorientated when they come out. They start having a problem with wondering who on earth they can trust. They have problems within their own families, adjusting back into family life, adjusting back into their own society. And again, bringing up this word society, I think one's really got to look at the type of society those children are being released back into. The type of society that is producing these sorts of children that can actually end up in jails. And it's a very, very serious problem. And this is one of the reasons we've actually called our campaign Free the Children rather than Release the Children, because we feel that the freedom of the child needs to go beyond just getting them out of prison. It actually we need to have a transformation within our society.
I think the implications are extremely serious. I think children need to be with their parents. Okay, children need to trust authorities in order to form a kind of good superego and a reasonable conscience. They have to develop a trust in the society in which they live in order to fulfill whatever they want to do. And in our society, I believe that is totally impossible at the moment. The authorities are malignant, for want of a better word. And they are not experiencing the kind of normal growing up environment in which children need to become so-called normal adults.
During this time that you were in detention, what did you think about while you were there?
I was thinking that these police, they are not good, and they are just taking us for nothing. They've taken us for nothing, and we are not able to write. Such things make us see that these police, they are not good.
But I mean, if one extrapolates what I've said in terms of not being able to form a reasonable superego and a conscience and a trust in society, you can either develop a whole lot of depressed children who are never able to relate to people, who never trust people. You can form a whole lot of antisocial children who have no idea what authority is about, what rules need to be enforced in order to have a reasonable society. So you could form a whole lot of antisocial personality disorders. But, I mean, I think that's pure speculation. I really don't know what will happen.
What do you think is going to happen? I mean, what has happened to you now and this experience that you've just had? What do you think is going to happen in the future?
The thing is, it won't end up here. It's going to continue, because if ever they've just detained me for this year, even next year they're going to detain me for without reason.
if they feel that the violence is part of the norm, that you kind of, if you get beaten up, you go and beat somebody else up. I mean, I think that the implications are quite obvious and quite serious, because they don't believe that the normal judicial processes are carrying out what should be done, and they take the law into their own hands. And I don't know where that stops.
I'm not staying at home. Even now, I'm not sleeping at home. I'm sleeping next door to some of my friends' homes. I'm not sleeping at home.
Why are you not sleeping at home? Are you afraid?
They told us that if they are going to release us, then give us 3 days. After 3 days, they are going to collect us and charge us.
How old are you, Gregory?
I'm 16 years old.